less than 10%, I think 4% people has died, but most of the people are getting infected and are becoming asymptomatic carrier. Asymptomatic carrier means, you know, I may have COVID virus, but I may not show any problem of COVID virus, and I may go out and mix with people. And the person who is coming in contact with me may get this infection. So that is something very, very difficult for all of us, because in our houses, old parents are there, old persons are there, and they may get infection from us. And in spite of the fact that we are very close relatives, we are the nearest and dearest ones, we may not go very near to our people. Not only that, because we are used to, you know, most of the people are gregarious, in the sense, you know, we are social being. We move in society, we go out in society, we discuss things in society, we go to colleges, we discuss, we deliberate, we fight at times. You know, fighting is also important. No, no, I do not agree with you. This is not good. This is not bad. This is bad. This is something I do not discuss. I do not agree with you. So all these have stopped completely. And we are really talking in a virtual space where we are seeing only the pictures and maybe listening. And time is also very short. So we cannot really deliberate. We cannot go to tea stalls and have a cup of tea. We cannot go to restaurant, malls, and you know, discuss certain things and have a good cup of coffee and things like that. It is something beyond our imagination. What is happening because of that? Mental health is also getting depressed. Many people are committing suicides. Many people are becoming suicidal, and depressive thoughts are coming. You know, this is not the way to live. People are thinking about that. So these are all COVID-19 syndrome. What is happening also, that people who are working outside, they cannot go outside or they cannot come inside because of the transport problem. We cannot move in buses because buses are not plying. Even if the buses are plying, the frequency is less. The government, all the governments, I must say, have taken enormous responsibility to stop this COVID-19 infection. See the point that India is a country and the United States is not a country. India is a country that has sacrificed its economy in order to save its people. So this is something spectacular. This is something great. This is something in the land of Buddha. It can happen that we always look after our people more than our money. So economic crisis is coming. Economic problem is coming, but life of people is more important to us, and we are maintaining that life of people. That is very, very important. We must know all this. Then the migrant workers who are in different states, they are trying to come to their houses. When they are coming, we do not know what kind of infection they are carrying. So when they are going to their houses, even people in their houses are skeptical. They are thinking, you know, they may carry infection. So there is some kind of distrust and mistrust that is also occurring among people. In my house, in the house adjacent to our house, there has been a death of an old man, and we have not gone there to see that person. Although I used to speak to him every morning, he used to smile at me. If there was any article published in the newspaper written by me, he used to call me and tell me that I agree on this part, I do not agree on this part. That person has died, and I have not been allowed to visit their house, because their house also does not like my visit. My house also does not like my visit to that house. So this is basically the disconnect. This COVID-19 has created the disconnect. C and D, COVID, Corona has created this disconnect. Do not enter my house. And most of the people are coming with gloves. People who are working as you know, we call them mashi. I do not like to call them maid servants. Very, very bad word. They are our people, and they come here for our work. And, you know, when they are coming, we are asking, you know, whether you have, you are taking care of your health, whether you are staying in a proper locality. And many people are getting jobless. I have seen to it that, you know, in my case, the person comes and does the work. The point is, all these are creating problems. Offices are closed. Many people have lost their jobs. Salaries have been cut. The media people know that the jobs have been lost. So this is a situation more than war. We do not know how to fight the virus. We may fight a person. We may fight a situation. We may fight a certain injustice, but we cannot fight the virus. 20 years ago, I was in. I had the opportunity to go to US for 2 years. There I heard a lecture by one Texas scientist who said something very interesting. He said, you know, the Malthusian idea that, you know, the population will grow and then, you know, there will be food crisis, there will be famine if the population goes up and all those. The point is, because of Green Revolution, we have been able to sustain the population, 40% extra population in this country because of Green Revolution. Fertilizers, pesticides, and good quality crops. Because of all those, we have been able to sustain a large number of people. All of you know about the Hebar process. Professor Shaktiprodo Bhoumik will know much better than me because he is teaching chemistry. Even now, I am not teaching that way. I am doing more administration. Professor Shaktiprodo Bhoumik will know that Hebar process, ammonia fertilizer in the last 100 years, 1919 was the year industrial production of ammonia was started. Point is, in 100 years, we have survived, a large population has survived because of this ammonia, which is basically coming from chemical industry, ammonia fertilizer. Now, that gentleman from Texas, he said something very interesting. He said, you know, you see the population growth and everything is so very fine. But he is a virologist. He works in virus. He was in Bose Institute. He did this PhD in Bose Institute and then went to Texas. Now he's a full professor there. And he said that from time to time, you will find the virus attack. They will come. In one go, they will create a lot of damage to human population. And they will go after vaccination. And a new virus will come. And this is how, he said, 20 years ago, he said, and I heard the lecture, he said that is how the balance of population will be maintained. So I took that. I did not take him very seriously. I said that, you know, he's a virologist. He is talking about virus. He works on virus. So he's speaking about that. This time, after 20 years, I could not connect to him. But I am remembering him that what he said is exactly correct. There is no vaccine, there is no medicine. Even the Western world with so much infrastructure and research cannot find a medicine. And we are getting, you know, swept away. In the United States, the most advanced country, so many people have died because of this COVID-19. So the point is, we are indeed in a war-like situation. It is pandemic, it is a global crisis. And in this global crisis, we really do not know how to move out. We have to find new ways. Although I like the classroom teaching the most, we are coming on this webinar because this webinar is giving us at least an opportunity to see the faces and to talk on a virtual platform. Many people say, you know, this online teaching is bad. I also feel, you know, that for this country, online teaching is still not the best solution. Maybe 50 years from now, when everyone gets internet, when the life, when the quality of life becomes good, maybe online teaching will be good. But the point is, when there is no option available, when all the roads are blocked, you will try to find out the by-lane and the lane through which you can move. And this lane and by-lane is basically this online system that is giving us an opportunity to continue our study and to give our lessons to our students through some means. Although it is not happening in the best possible way, it is happening in some way. Now, I always say there is a proverb in Bengali, Nai mamar theke kana mama bhalo. What is the meaning? Meaning is, if you do not have any uncle, maternal uncle, that situation is worse than when you have at least one maternal uncle who is blind. The point is, this online system may not go to every student, but the point is, it is going to at least some students. And this sum is better than none. So at least with the facility that we have now at our disposal, and with the initiative of Professor Shaktiprata Bhoumik, Professor Soma Ghosh, Professor Choidali Bhattacharya, and all other teachers, Chandrabali, Pradipto, all others, IQAC coordinator, many, many names, we have been able to do this kind of interaction on virtual platform. It is indeed a crisis. We have not been able to hold our examination. We do not know how to take these those examinations, and the students here must be pleased to know that, you know, we are trying to overcome this crisis. We have you, all of your faces are in our minds. The principal thinks about you. All the principals think about you. The vice chancellor thinks about you. The teachers think about you. You know, you have all the parents in your institutions. All the parents, not your biological parents. We are all parents, and we are looking after your need, and we are trying to save the situation. But the point is, save you from the situation. But the point is, you know, there are many, many roadblocks. We do not know. We have not faced this pandemic anytime earlier. So we do not have any experience. We are used to this paper and pen teaching and learning process and lecture, and then PowerPoint teaching and learning process and examination and checking those papers. Now we are faced with a situation where we really do not know how to continue with the process of teaching and learning. So it is indeed a learning experience, but this country is 5,000 years old. This country has faced so many problems. Professor Shaktiprata Bhoumik has talked about partition. Before partition, this country has faced many, many problems. 1757, the Battle of Plassey. Before that, the other historical problems, all of you know. You know history better than me because you are studying history. There are professors of anthropology and psychology and sociology. They know much better than me the sociological aspects of what really goes on in society. So the point is, I am finally an optimist. Even if you know, Rabindranath said something very interesting. If you close the door, I'll open a window. If you close the windows, I'll try to find out one hole through which light comes. Right? So we must find light. These Bengali race and nation, these Bengali race, they are extremely imaginative. They are extremely hardworking. And if they want, they can get things done, I can tell you. And in this situation, Professor Shaktiprata Bhoumik, Dr. Soma Ghosh, Dr. Choidali Bhattacharya, Chandrabali, Pradipto, Bashab Choudhury, all of us are together to fight this COVID. And we must be together. We must work hard. We must be together maintaining social distancing. We must be together with our gloves on. We must go to our students, and we must see, ensure that no student gets victimized because of this problem. Please take from me. We will try to save your future in the most optimal fashion. Please try to bear with us, and please listen to different webinars. Read a lot. Point is, everyone has books in their houses. But time is here to read them seriously. Read storybooks, read different other books, read newspapers, and try to, you know, educate yourself. Because, you know, ultimately education gives you the liberty, you know. Swami Vivekananda has said again and again, what is the problem in this country? He said, poverty and education, poverty and lack of education, daridra and oshikha. Poverty and lack of education. So if we can come out of poverty, if we can come out of this lack of education, we must overcome. This country is 5,000 years old. This country is rich. This country has so many things, you know, we must be together, and we must try to take our people forward. That should be the mission, you know. No small thing, I tell you, never think of smallness. Always think, you know, large. This COVID-19 is very small. That is very tiny. And we are so large. But the point is, you know, they are so united. You see, the virus has one purpose: to destroy human life. Right? What should be our purpose? To destroy those tiny, tiny materials. It's very tiny, but very powerful. And we are we are larger, much larger as compared to them, but we must have the sense of purpose to be together and to fight against those viruses. I am very happy that this webinar has been kept open. Many established researchers and experts and professors from Jamia Millia and other institutions, Calcutta University, my university, that was my university. I worked there for from 1991 to 2015. I started working at the age of 28 something, and I worked there up to 2015, at a stretch. That is the only job I did in Calcutta University. Other jobs, they were all part-time. But Calcutta University job is the only job, and after that, this tenure appointment that I have in West Bengal State University. So Calcutta University professor is there, very rich university. Jamia Millia University has done very good in NIRF. Calcutta University has done very good in NIRF, and I'm proud of them. They're all our fraternity. They are people. Point is, they are together here today to take part in this webinar and to reach you and to discuss on COVID-19. I am so very happy. Whenever our teachers do something good, I always say, my success does not drive me anymore. I have written in a piece 1 month or 2 months ago that has been published. He asked me, what drives you? Really, my success does not drive me anymore. I am already 58. What will happen? I always tell my son and daughter, I may retire anytime. You people just go out and do something good. That only gives me pleasure. My daughter is a doctor. So I always look at her and see that, she is doing well. So that is the only thing I have in my mind. I see my students. When they come, they are lacking in confidence. When they go out, they are full of confidence. And that confidence is needed in this country. That confidence is needed in the society. If we can prepare good, confident people, we do not need anything else. And their success, your success, my dear students, my teacher's success, that only drives me. My brothers, my sisters, who are teaching in colleges and universities, their success only drives me. So that is basically, my motivation to speak to you. And I am indeed grateful to Professor Shoktiproto Bhoumik and Dr. Shoma Ghosh for inviting me and for giving me this opportunity. All of my teachers are extremely erudite. All of my teachers are extremely experienced in colleges and universities. There is no distinction between college and university. When I was small, I was a school student, I will tell you, I got highest respect for the principals. When I was small in a school, maybe I was in class 6 or 7. At that time, we had a culture of going to hear different lectures by experts, in meetings and other things. So I went there, and one evening at about 10 o'clock, some lecture was going on. And there was a principal of the college, and he was presiding. And there are many big people, even a minister was there. So the college students were not listening. So the principal got up and said, I am the principal. I am asking those students, my students, please do not speak at all. Listen to the lectures. And then there was pin drop silence for 1 hour. And I thought, my dear friend, my God, this principal is so very powerful. Someday I will become principal if I can. So, principals are my principals, my teachers. They're all very gifted. They're all very experienced. They are good. They're having real knowledge and erudition. So they have given me a chance to inaugurate this seminar, which I am doing with great humility. We have learned to become humble. My father told me, every time that when big people or someone comes to your house, try to be humble to that person. Matha nichu kore kotha bolbi. That means you speak to them with your head down so that you do not become overreactive. Do not become that, like that. So he taught me. I do not know. I have been able to pass that message to my son and daughter. I have not been able to. Maybe I have not been able to do that. But humility is very important. And I am doing it with all humility. If you become humble, I tell you, God comes to your door. Become humble. We always pray to God by folding our knees, by being on our knees. Why? Because God is great and we are small. So be on your knees and try to follow your teacher, because teacher is good. Teacher is, you know, Pitri Devo Bhava, Matri Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava. Acharya Devo Bhava, teacher, be my God. Acharya Devo Bhava. So that is what, you know, and I say Chhatra Devo Bhava. Chhatra Devo Bhava means student, you are my God. So God cannot be unkind. God cannot be bad. When a student comes and tells me that, you know, shouts, you know, that, sir, why has it not happened? I said, my dear friend, you are my God. So when you speak like God. So that is what is important. I am doing it with all humility. Dr. Shoma Ghosh, Professor Shukti Prato Bhoumik, they have given me this chance to inaugurate this seminar, which I am doing. I do not know what I have spoken. My point is, you know, I always go this extempore and speak what comes to my mind, because I always feel that I am becoming more real by speaking from my mind. I am becoming more real. And the real thing is important. Do not become unreal. Be real. Be true. Be true to yourself. Shakespeare in Hamlet has said, and finally, be true. To thine own self be true, you cannot be false to any man. To thine own self be true, you must be true to yourself. Unless you become true to yourself, you cannot be true to the society. In this COVID-19 situation, we must be true to ourselves. We must take care of ourselves. We must put mask on. We must put gloves on. We must not infect others. We must try to take care of our health. And when we talk to other people, we will also ensure that they do not become infected by us, and they do not infect us. That should be the spirit. And I have spoken a lot. I think Dr. Shoma Ghosh is definitely getting frustrated that I have taken a long time to speak. I have become old. Professor Shukti Bhoumik knows that I have become old, and because of that, once I get mic, I go on talking. That is very bad, of course. And I am scolded by my family again and again that you are talking too much, particularly my wife. So she says that you are talking too much. So I will not speak more. I request you to stay safe, take care of yourself, take care of families, take care of your teachers, take care of your neighbors and everyone by being safe and by keeping people safe. Thank you very much, and I wish the webinar all success. It is my pleasure to inaugurate the webinar with all humility. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Soma, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Actually, please offer thanks and gratitude to Professor Bhagat Choudhury on behalf of both the colleges. You just do offer thanks and gratitude on behalf of both the colleges.
And I'll take the opportunity to thank not only Professor Bhaskar Choudhury, who is always with the colleges, college principals, college teachers, students. He is so generous and he is so humble, down to earth. It's unimaginable in other universities of India, maybe of the universe. So we are really grateful, and I express my gratitude to Professor Bhaskar Choudhury on behalf of both the colleges, APC College and Hiralal Mazumdar Memorial College for Women. And Professor Choudhury has always graced every occasion of both the colleges, every academic seminars. He is really an inspiration for all of us. And along with that, I express my gratitude to my senior, Professor Shaktiprata Bhoumik. He is the principal of APC College, and he is like my elder brother. And whenever I ask him for any sort of help, he provides me with that assistance. So thank you, Shaktida. Choitali Di, honorable governing body member, government nominee. She is always being a very good advisor and always a very good didi of for me. So thank you. There are lots of other elder senior academicians, Professor Bula Bhadra, Professor Shobita Choudhury. I heartily welcome all of them, and thank you for being with us. Professor Roma Kaur, I welcome you as well. And I congratulate both the coordinators of IQSC coordinators of both the colleges, Mr. Shubhro Ghoshal from APC College and Dr. Rupa Shen from our college, Hiralal Mazumdar Memorial College, for organizing such a wonderful seminar in which we have with us Professor Bashrup Chowdhury, a very resourceful person. Actually, Professor Chowdhury asked me what is actually the topic. I just didn't say that it is all about health calamity, because I know his knowledge is all pervasive. So I wanted that our participants listen to him he can share his knowledge about different aspects. So, and he did so. So we are really thankful and being enlightened. I thank my bursar, Madam Dr. Lipika Molli, for always being with me in all my endeavors. Chandra Boli, Prodeep, and last but most importantly, my two technical hands, one from history, Atrey, and the other from computer science, Pooja, for responding in all my odd endeavors. Thank you. And this is the end of the inaugural session, and let's move on for the technical session. I'll request Professor Choitali Bhattacharjo and Dr. Chandra Boli Dotto to continue the sessions.
Thank you, Principal Madam. First speaker is from sociology. I request Professor Chandra Boli Dotto to introduce him to the audience.
Thank you, ma'am. I would now like to request Professor Arvindar A. Ansari. Before that, I would like to introduce her to all whoever present here. Professor Arvindar A. Ansari is Professor of Sociology, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. He is one of the renowned sociologists of India, whose work in areas of sociology of ethnicity and minorities, sociology of gender, feminist theory, cultural studies and identity, sociology of violence, etc., has received national and international recognition. She has conducted and completed several and major research projects and published many books, chapters in books, as well as journal articles. Professor Ansari is also the convener of the ad hoc group Ethnicity and Minority Studies of Indian Sociological Society, and she has also been a member of the Research Committee on Gender and Society, Sociology of Childhood and Youth. She has been actively involved in various academic and administrative duties of her university and various other national and international institutions and organizations. Today, we are extremely honored and privileged to have Professor Ansari with us. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting my invitation and our invitation, rather. And now I would like to request you to share your valuable thoughts with us. Arvindar, ma'am.
Thank you very much. I hope I am audible. And I'd really like to thank the organizers of this international webinar to give me an opportunity to talk about COVID-19, which is a very, very, you know, important theme for all of us to reflect and discuss about it. I take this opportunity to, you know, also acknowledge the participation of Professor Basap Chaudhary, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Shoma Ghosh, Professor Bhomik, my dear colleague, Professor Bula Badra, you know, for making me part of this discussion. From the inaugural session, we have been hearing about the COVID-19 and the imperatives it has for the health and the well-being. So today I'm actually going to look at COVID-19 and its imperatives on health and well-being of the society, because this is a very, very important and significant relationship that we cannot talk about lives and livelihoods in a segregated manner. So we have to somewhere talk about the two, and they are very well linked. Friends, you know, in her introduction, Chandrapali Datta also mentioned about a very important sociological construct that risk societies. So what is this risk societies? And sociologist Ulrich Beck has talked about the fear of modern societies slipping into risk societies, how modernization or post-modernization has pushed us towards the such kind of fringes, and why we are there. This is again a very important question, but yes, definitely COVID-19 has come as a shock to international community, to humanity, because it has also exposed us to our vulnerabilities at global level, that what are our health infrastructures, how are we going to cope up with, and when we are in 21st century talking about a pandemic which has completely overtaken us and has caught us off guard, is a serious matter, and it needs a further introspection that, this development, this technology, and all these developments, researches, are somewhere for the welfare, the huge investments which we make in development are something which is talking about that we, each development, each contribution of science and technology is looked as a step towards making human life more comfortable, making societies more humane. But what has come to us is a shock as far as COVID-19 is concerned. So, the vulnerability of this has brought in very important question of social anxiety, which has been talked. But before coming to social anxiety, I would also like to say that the outbreak of coronavirus has revealed how a biological and epidemiological issue can be transformed into a social, economic, and political subject. The most common and the most important strategies of states facing this virus has been public health approach, enhancing the capacity of clinics and hospitals, and strict quarantine of infected patients. Campaigns for hand washing and cough etiquettes were commonly used. However, the demands have gone much further. Despite lack of evidence for use of masks by general population, an enormous demand for buying masks occurred worldwide. Many daily activities, even in cities without confirmed cases, were affected. Quarantine of large cities and some sort of home confinement for even unaffected persons occurred. In a rare event, some countries closed their borders and restricted their flights. So this restriction on human mobility is also very important. Very important consequence of coronavirus outbreak is the creation of social anxiety worldwide. This has led to serious concerns for citizens in all countries. Even in the societies without confirmed outbreak, the sense of disappointment, especially among the younger generations, heralds how our societies are vulnerable in facing these hazards. Risk society is part of daily life. Beck defines it as a systematic way of dealing with hazards and insecurities induced and introduced by modernization. He attributes this to a far-reaching change, which he calls reflexive modernization, where unintended and unforeseen side effects of modern life backfire on modernity, questioning the very basis of its definition. Coronavirus outbreak shows that risk society leads to vulnerable society, how it affects the social structure, and how it has exposed the social stratification, the intersectionality of class, caste, and gender is very much visible. We see that pregnant women, families with children, older adults, disabled, low-income individuals suffer disproportionate harm in epidemics and disasters. In the case of this epidemic, all groups in communities felt that once
Hello, is there any technical problem? She is not audible. Hello. Hello, Pradeep.
Madam, she has muted herself. Oh, now it's open.
You know, this in case of this corona epidemic, all groups in communities felt that they are at risk. That is why in risk society, huge investments should be made to study risk perceptions and communications, largely with the aim of managing conflicting opinions and magnitudes of hazards that are affecting us. Now, very importantly, I would like to bring into discussion very important fact that how it has exposed the inequalities as far as health facilities are concerned, that who are people who can get. So definitely we have seen, and especially in context of India, where we have seen that huge number of migrant laborers, that they had to leave the cities in which they were working. Now, what was there in their mind which they were leaving? Why, you know, this whole handling of the COVID-19 led to another kind of hazard. Has put the lives of people at risk. Because if you would see, the question of governance is also very important as far as COVID-19 is concerned, the vision. Because if we say that COVID-19 is a medical emergency, it's a situation of war, so what was our preparedness to deal with this kind of war is a very important question. So, you know, one very important significant thing that we are talking about modernization, we have talked about equality, we have talked about democracy, but all these things have, you know, all the way the events have been unfolded has brought back to very important significant fact that, one, we were not medically prepared. Second, very important was lack of vision to handle, especially in case of India. If you look at the the lockdowns. Now, why is lockdown needed? Yes, lockdown is needed. Stay at home is a very important strategy with the pandemic, but lockdown and stay at home is a buffer. We prepare ourselves. Here in Delhi, every day we see that the cases are escalating. Not only escalating, there is, the state governments have done, especially in context of Delhi. I can, with no inhibition and with not missing any word, I would like to say that that state has left people to fend for themselves. They have left people to fend for themselves. We see that how, you know, not only the people are at risk, also the health workers. I was talking to the doctors in All India Medical Sciences. So, you know, the lack of basic facilities or equipments required to fight with such kind of situation is really very important to talk about, to discuss, and to work upon. Second, very important, the unpreparedness, the way the lockdowns were announced, the hoarding of essential items was also something very insignificant. We cannot say that it needs our discussion and attention, that we need to talk about that, how, why people have to leave places where they have been working for years and years. Now, you see, very interesting, COVID-19 also followed the norms of social stratification. It first affected people who were at lower middle class, the migrant laborers, then lower middle class. Now it is affecting middle class. You know, businesses are being closed down. People are thrown out of jobs because there is no, there has been complete lockdown. The economy has been on standstill. So, you know, now this brings an important question, that what is the relationship between the two? There is a very, very important relationship between health and wealth. You know, once there is this kind of standstill in this economy, in the social system, so lockdown was perceived to break the chain, which it did not do because of the lack of the vision, but definitely it broke down the chain of supplies. Essential items went out from the market. Farmers were completely at the mercy of the state, where they were not able to kind of deal with the situation. They had to throw away their vegetables, which they did not find buyers because there were strict norms of total isolation and there was complete curfew, one would talk about it. It is not only that the different sections, the economic vulnerabilities were observed, there were also, we see the cultural inequalities. Women have been affected differently because now we see where women have to meet the demands of ration, meet the demands of water, because they need now more water for cleaning their house, for hygiene and sanitation. So again, we see that gender has been impacted differently, and of course, her nutrition level has also gone down, because in most of the family, we see that it is women who eats last in the family, and it is still prevalent in the there are very few lucky women, and the way the cities have been at risk is also a very important question. In Delhi especially, I mean, since I live here, and my observation and my insights come from the city itself, and the city had been in discussion in news for the way a particular community was also held responsible for spreading this epidemic. But you know, not only in India, we see that there have been examples from other countries also, where racial minorities have been also kind of targeted for the spread of. So you know, these are the socio-cultural impacts. Now, why it is happening? This happens because of social anxiety. This happens because of fear. Because when there is scarcity of resources, everybody wants to hoard those resources for themselves. That is, you know, somewhere, you know, that sense that I me myself. But thankfully, civil society has played a very important role in dealing with this kind of pandemic. And Veena Das recently wrote a article in her Deccan Herald, if I'm not mistaken, where she has said that can we leave the work of relief and rehabilitation, philanthropy to the civil society? What happens to digital India? We were talking about digital India, and why ever, you know, not only it has brought in the medical vulnerability, the lack of infrastructure in a healthcare industry, it has not only exposed the lack of infrastructure in healthcare industry, it has also exposed the very weak PDS infrastructure in our country. We have been talking about linking Aadhaar and PAN card. And why could not we link the Aadhaar and PAN card with the welfare schemes? You know, when Amartya Sen has said that all these policies which we start with the policies keeping in mind the most vulnerable, the most deprived person in the society. But what mechanism we had to check that the person who had walked for 1200 kilometers has reached safely to his village, to her village, and has been taken care of? We have no mechanisms to map that. Why, you know, this is something very important to talk about, that we are talking about India in 21st century, and we have been talking about India, digital India. There also we see that lack of digital infrastructure and lack of the digital literacy is something very significant, which has multiplied the grievances. Because, you know, very interestingly, I would like to share a case study from Mandrega in EPW, a very recent article, where, you know, the lady who is working in Rajasthan is will get her remuneration for working in Mandrega through bank transfer. So that is that money would be automatically transferred to her account. And interestingly, it says that link is not working. The link is not updated. And it is 8 months. She has completed her 100 days and she's still going every day. So the link is not working. The link is not working. Now, this is new normal. So you see that, you know, what kind of, if the immediate relief is not reached, the immediate relief which we required at this time was liquid cash. And I'm sure during demonetization somewhere, there would have been an arrangement there would have been a mechanism where we could have ensured that people are getting money. There was so much of emphasis on opening up bank accounts for you know, subsidy for your LPG gases. So that system is very much there. Why could not people get the liquid cash into it? Why cannot we had a plan B ready for such kind of eventualities? Where why could not we rope in our local MLAs for reaching out to the people during elections? They are able to reach us. Why the civil defense, ASHA worker, these people were not roped in to reach the people who really required me? So you know, the fluctuating stand of the state that you need test and you don't need test is creating a lot of confusion. So this confusion is also adding to the social anxiety along with the economic difficulties which people are facing. So you know, these are very important questions, that how are we going to deal? COVID-19 is not the end. COVID-19 would be replaced by something else, some other future pandemics. So how are we using our artificial intelligence? You know, there is so much of fear in the mind of people for surveillance that they don't feel comfortable with Arogya Setu. Why? You know, at least that trust is very important. And why people now feel that they have to fend for themselves? In Delhi, residential societies have started making arrangements for their own oximeters, oxygen cylinders. They have converted their lobbies into makeshift hospitals where they can provide that kind of relief. So such is the situation, and such is the situation of a country in 21st century. I'm not talking globally, it is there. Globally it is there, but then there are examples of Slovenia, there are examples of South Korea, there is example from New Zealand, who could manage, who could reach out the people, who could control the outbreak with a vision and with a proper strategy in a place. So that is very important, that you know, when if we want to be in the front lines of in developed nations, advanced nations, then it is very important that high time that we talk about public health policies, because the way the public health policies have collapsed in the present situation is a very, very important reflection that where we are standing in terms of development. Health and education, I'm not talking about education right now because that is not in the core of my discussion. I'm just focusing on health and the well-being. So health and well-being, lives and livelihoods are very, very much interrelated. So we have to have a plan where we have to see that what kind of mechanisms have to be put in place so that in case of such emergencies where you know, stay at home becomes a mandatory condition, how health facilities should reach to people. And what should be the cost of these health facilities reaching out to the people? Because if the health facilities are out of our reach, so are they are as good as non-existing. So you know, the risks. We as we go ahead, as we progress, as we move towards modernization. So you know, it is very important that we also have backup plans to manage risk societies, because technological societies are going to be highly risk societies. And this is the path of development we have chosen. So we have to be very careful in terms of, and not only careful, transparent, honest, and democratic in dealing with such kind of pandemics, where at least if we could not do much, we should control the social anxiety. We should give the assurance to people that you would be looked after. The state will give you the best maximum it can afford. So that is very important. And people now are scared for their lives. And you know, this fear for life has made them more you know, concerned about I, me, myself. But still, my hats off to civil societies, organizations, philanthropic organizations who have come down, who came out to help and support the migrant laborers when they were moving out of the cities, whether it is metropolitan cities, Delhi, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Mumbai. to reach back to their hometowns, villages, where they at least had this security that they will be among their own near and dear ones when they die. Another very 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 painful aspect is that how, you know, we have dealt with the dead bodies. That is something very very painful aspect of this whole COVID-19, that, you know, in many places we came across cases where a young child who was 13 year 14 year of age is asked, because of the lack of healthcare workers, because that is one very important area which needs to be looked at. And very importantly, that we need to strengthen the healthcare industry. We need to strengthen the medical colleges of our country. You know, the exorbitant fees of students who want to pursue their career in medicine is becoming out of reach of it. It is becoming out of reach of middle class. So we have to work on these parameters to see that how, because if we have a good health, now look, the whole idea and the emphasis is that we have to have a good immunity. Good immunity would only be possible when we have a good health system. I just saw Bula Badra's question, is risk hierarchically situated? Yes, risk is hierarchically situated. That's what I've said, talked in my early part, that risk, this COVID-19 has exposed the inequalities and public health inequalities also, that people, people who can afford are having a good access to healthcare, and people like, you know, middle class also, there has been this myth, people who are bureaucrats, people who thought that we are professors, we have, you know, are also now exposed to that. It is now very few. I think 1% of Indian population can say that they can avail medical facilities as of now. Rest all have to fend for themselves in the way, you know, they kind of, they can manage and maneuver this. So, you know, it is very important that we need to work on this, and we need to raise these questions, because whenever there have been elections, we have never raised the question of public health policy, we have never raised the question of education, we have never raised the question of employment, you know, we have always talked about other unimportant issues of ethnicity, polarization, and other, communalism has always been a very important areas of discussion, rather than these very important issues, which are very significant. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor, for your enlightening lecture. Now we would like to request participants to write their questions in chat box so that Professor Ansari can give her answers. So participants, those who want to ask any question to Professor Ansari, kindly write their questions in the chat box. Read it out.
Chandrabuli?
Yes, hello?
It is better to raise the question afterwards, as Choitali Madam has already pointed out. Choitali Madam, please do the needful.
Okay.
What do you mean, Pudipto? I can't understand. I will raise the question, or I will summarize the meeting. What do you mean? Pudipto.
I think you just continue the meeting, and after the meeting, the question answer will be held.
Pudipto?
Interactive session will be.
Madam.
Pudipto? So far I feel that
madam,
after, hello Pradipto, can you hear me?
Yes, Suma.
Yes. Okay. Yes, madam.
Choitali Di, with due regards to Choitali Di and everyone senior to me, may I request that after every session, yes, we accommodate 3 to 5 questions, because the speakers who may have some other business to do and they may leave.
Okay, madam.
Then Chandrapuni will moderate and hand it over to Choitali madam.
Sure. Is it possible,
Pradipta? Is it okay?
Sure, madam. Sure.
Thank you.
Okay. Professor Ansari, there is one question from Shorbani Guho Ghoshal. What is the most important crisis point, inadequate health service or inadequate economic arrangement in dealing the issue?
Both. You know, inadequate health service has also given rise to this the question of economy also. You know, they are interrelated. You cannot see them separately. That is very important, because if you would see in India, the situation escalated not because of the health emergency in the beginning, that is on 22nd, 23rd or 24th March. It became worse because of the fear, lockdown. People did not have, savings. People did not have, because, you know, if you would see, the majority of the people in India are employed in unorganized. So for middle class, or you can say upper middle class, it was a kind of, okay, you know, initially the experience was very different, that, okay, it's a kind of paid vacation and everybody enjoyed 15 days then another 15 days. But now you can see the brunt on the middle class also, because, you know, there are various cuts coming, there are various, you know, kind of other, like say, even if we say we talk about bank moratorium on your loan or your EMIs, but after 3 months you have to pay a very hefty amount of interest on that. So, you know, these are, and also economy is very important. When you ask a person to buy a mask, the first thing he would like to buy a pack of biscuit for her child, the migrant labor, then buying a mask. So you see, these are all very, very important, interrelated. So it is not in a day that you can, you can cover all these things. We need a very, very strong medical health system, which would have, you know, kind of given that should have laid that emphasis on hygiene and sanitation. We were running, Swachh Bharat program since years. What is this Swachh Bharat program? Do we had enough, these kind of facilities for the people, the most vulnerable people? And again, if you see the in present context also, both are interrelated. Only people who have money have access to the medical facility right now. See the packages which are coming from the government, from the hospitals, whether it is private, government, there is no place. There is no place. And in private hospitals, if you have money, then only you will get a bed. So we cannot disassociate life from livelihoods.
Okay, hello. Yeah, thank you. Yes. There is one more question from Shombriya Chatterjee. She has asked, in which way the metro cities of India can overcome the COVID-19 situation, because there are various types of issues of it.
Look, again, it is the infrastructure. Now, metro cities are more, experience and the observation has shown that metro cities have been more vulnerable, because the mobility one factor is very important, is there. And also the hierarchy, the social stratification is also too spread in metropolitan cities, in metropolitan cities. So, you know, to overcome, like for instance, Kerala has been able to do it. Why Kerala has been able to handle it efficiently? Right from day one, they diagnosed a case. So they were active. They had all the policies in place. They had a collective kitchen, which was working efficiently. And if you would look at the collective kitchens at other places, the kind of food they were serving, the kind of place they had, the jump on the policies. For instance, if we see Delhi, you know, they say in the first 15 days of the lockdown that it is very important to quarantine social distance, which is again a very, very misnomer. Physical distance is very important. And, you know, complete lockdown. Another 15 days, more strict curfew comes. And then suddenly you say that it is not very important for everyone to get the test done. Because why suddenly, you know, this new guideline comes that there is no need for everyone to get tested. And, so, you know, this kind of shift and this kind of jump creates, and the medicines go out of the market. Medicines, you know, basic medicines like paracetamol, and also the kind of surveillance that if you are buying a paracetamol in the first 15 days, the guidelines were that if you are buying these basic medicines, the chemist was supposed to write down the name and everything of the patient who has come, or anybody else who has come. So, you know, these kind of fluctuating guidelines, these kind of things had created a lot of confusion. So, very important is to is a vision. How do we deal with it? How do we deal with it? You know, that vision was very important and it required a planning. And what has happened in especially Maharashtra and Delhi is that we had been dealing with the situation as it is coming. We had been, we have been taking two steps forward and two steps backward, looking at the situation which is emerging. One fine day we say that tests are important, mandatory. Second day we say that tests are not important. Then quarantine is important. Then we say home quarantine is better. So this is something which points to the which really needs a very, very efficient statesmanship and vision. We could have dealt with it. But the thing is that there should have been a mechanism to do that. There is a mechanism. There are civil defense workers. There are healthcare workers in each constituency. So everybody should have been given assigned a role for that kind of preparedness. It is not only after one the TV channels report and then you get active on doing these kind of arrangements or, you know, plans to deal with.
Thank you, madam. Unfortunately, we cannot take all the questions right now because other speakers are also waiting. I'd just like to read out Professor Bashup Chaudhary's answer to Sri Jagdish Manna and Mampi De. Sir has written that regarding scientific new information, briefly, the vaccine research is on and reported that one steroid is somewhat successful, so work is in progress, life is taking test, moving on with patients is the way out. So Professor Chaudhary has just shared his answer with us. So we are extremely sorry that we are not able to...
We are having a question from Professor Bula Bhadro to Madam. Madam, Bula Bhadro has asked that is risk hierarchy hierarchically structured from a class perspective in India?
Pradipta, I think Professor Ansari has already answered. She has already responded to Professor Bula Bhadro's question.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Yes. So, Professor Ansari, if it is possible, you can just... write the answers in the chat box if it is possible for you, or if madam agrees, then she can share the answers with us so that we can just post it later.
It will be wonderful, and may I request Professor Ansari to do that for us?
Yeah,
it was a very wonderful and enlightening session.
Please,
so people
please
are having questions, many questions.
I will try to respond. Sure.
But I apologize for this shortage of time.
No, it happens. This is normal. this is normal. We are getting used to new normals, and this is normal. This is traditional normal. So it's no problem. Webinars and seminars have time constraint. I agree with that. And you know, again, I would thank you for giving you giving me opportunity to share my views, which I mean, still I am kind of reading on risk societies and how to, you know, sociologically we can look at it. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now I would like to ask Professor Choitali Bhattacharya to kindly continue the next session. Madam?
Okay, thank you. I may introduce now Professor Arup Ratan Bandyopadhyay, head of the department and professor of anthropology in University of Calcutta. He did MPhil and PhD from University of Calcutta, India. He is the recipient of UGC Research Fellowship for pursuing PhD qualifying national eligibility test, Merit Awards and Young Scientist Awards from Indian Science Congress. Professor Bandyopadhyay is teaching entirely postgraduate level for more than 27 years and successfully guided many PhD students, now working still with 7 registered students. He was the president of Anthropological and Behavioral Sciences section of the Indian Science Congress in its centenary year. He published more than 100 anthropological research articles in different national and international journals, and also delivered many invited lectures in national and international platform on evolutionary biology, forensic anthropology, dental anthropology, public health in relation to medical genetics, cytogenetics, and anthropometry of non-communicable disease, genetic polymorphism of communicable and non-communicable disease, dermatoglyphics in medical and psychiatric disorders, population genetics, and human rights issue. I may mention his recent publication on COVID in a renowned science journal of Southeast Asia. Please, Dr. Arup Ratan Bandyopadhyay, please proceed.
Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
So I would like to share my presentation. So I'm trying out, because I'm not very much comfortable with this one, but I'm trying out to share my presentation. So is it fine that, can you see my presentation? Anybody can see my presentation? Can you tell me? My presentation is there.
Hello, Pradipto. Hello, Pradipto. Have we that?
Madam, bolun.
Provisions, have we that provisions to see some presentations or like that projection or like that?
Yeah, we have the provision. Professor sir, if you have using your yes sir, it is presenting. Yes, it is presenting, sir. Yeah.
Okay, shall I start?
Okay, sir.
Okay, so I'm trying to start.
Just continue with the process. Continue with the process, sir.
It's all right. It is in the screen that everybody can see it.
Okay, thank you.
It's all right. Thank you so much. So this is really, really, this is an opportunity to speak on the webinar, and I have already listened to Professor Basav Chaudhary and Madam from Jamia Millia Islamia, and this is really a good occasion to listen this one. So I'll be talking about the anthropological perspectives of COVID-19 pandemic, post risk factors and its impact. So firstly, I would like to go with this COVID pandemic. So this is, again, going on the human history. That pandemic is going on with the human history. And this has remained very much mysterious till now, displays some paradoxical character. Yes?
Sir, your presentation is not visible, sir. So you have to minimize this screen, and your presentation should be maximized. Then we can see it.
Which screen I should minimize, Obhishikta?
Sir, your this Gmeet screen should be minimized, and your presentation should be maximized.
This is all right now?
So it should come up.
This is all right now?
Not yet, sir.
Sir, this is Dipendu. You have to open the, in your window, you have to open your presentation, then you minimize, and then you have to show it.
Okay.
share with your screen. You have to open it first in your window.
I have opened it. Yeah. Yes. I opened it.
It is not coming, sir.
Is it coming now?
No, it is not coming, sir.
No, it's not coming.
Oh my God, this is again a problem. You know, I always get it down with the problem. So what should I do? Can anybody give me a quick?
Sir, just stop presenting and then again start afresh with presenting.
Then present now?
So you share your screen now, sir.
I'm sharing my screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Select window, PowerPoint. Hello.
Yes.
Now
it will come right?
Is it all right?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So
okay,
just
you so much.
Slide
yes,
show
sir,
it
perfect.
Now.
Perfect.
It's perfect.
Okay, fine. Fine. Thank you so much, everybody. Two of my friends, Vishita and Dipendra, helping me out.
We are not visualizing your presentation.
But yes, sir. It's visible now. We just.
Right. It is coming.
Thank you so much. I'm going very fast and the questions will be coming. I feel that questions are very important. And most of the things are known to the people with the media and other digital medias and the newspapers, magazines. So I'm going very fast with this one. Because till now this COVID-19 is a kind of Trojan horse that we know about the computer. This is, we do not know where it will work in the which software. Now, it is coming to us with a varying degree of processing as a lethal dictator worldwide and happening to be bioterrorism in the entire human population. Now, this is a kind of joke I'm telling you to the citizens, not to the netizens, because we are now in the net. So we don't use the masks and other kind of, so all the citizens, and since human population inclusive of citizens and netizens, therefore anthropological holistic aspects might have an imperative understanding. So on that particular basis, I'm going with this one. So whoever in the anthropology discipline or other discipline can understand that this epidemic started with when the population grows bigger from hunting, foraging to hunting, gathering to agrarian system. So this pandemic comes up, and this pandemic, you can understand this is very common to us. It started in December 2019 in Wuhan city and came to the whole world, and WHO COVID-19 qualified pandemic worldwide. And you can understand there are bats, there are animals. So we can understand it's coming from the animals to the human. So this is the history of the global calamities, and you can see that in the red box, that is the type of pre-human host, and you'll find that most of the hosts are being the fly, I mean any kind of animal. So that's why this is known as a zoonotic disease, that we are coming from the animal to the human and then human to human. So this is known as a zoonotic disease. And this is actually what happened to the SARS-CoV, just I'm going very fast, these are very much known till now. So this is again a classification has been given in the left side, that this is neurovirus. And then the important part is the SARS-CoV, you know, that already Professor Chaudhary has talked about this MERS, Middle East, and the SARS-CoV-1, that was CoV-1. So you can understand this is only a very small single-head RNA, approximately 26 to 32 kb in size. But in the human, this is more than 3 million base pairs. And Professor Chaudhary said that they are making us devastating. But I'm just giving you another view. This is not, they had not come up for devastating us, but to reproduce themselves, because they are the lice. So the lice always, this is one of the criteria of the lice, that to go for the reproduction. So they are making the reproduction, and then for the particular reproduction, they need to have a host. So this spike proteins, everybody, we know this, are the, you know, this has been coming in the paper, in the media, in the digitally. So this spike protein, so they are the guests. So we are the host, you know, that we need to have a door to open. So the door is a receptor, what the people say, ACE2. So this SE2 is a receptor for us, and this SE2s are mainly found in our lungs, I mean the nasal cavity and the mouth. So this SE2 receptor, so that's why the people say that don't give your hand to your nose and the mouth repeatedly without washing, because these are the doors that is much more open in the lungs and the tongue. And now this is the physiology which is actually going on with this particular COVID. So this is known as renin angiotensin system. Ras, who are from the biological background, can understand this one. So these are the situation that we are getting. So what happens that it regulates intestinal bacterial balance to regulate amino acid absorption, and this protects the lungs from the COVID infection, reduced inflammatory cytokines. I'll talk about this cytokines just after some time, and regulate immune.
Sir, and the presentation is not visible.
Again,
it was not.
It's okay.
It's coming up.
Now it's fixed.
It's coming up.
Oh, can you?
Yes. But it's coming up to somebody, and not somebody. Somebody is trying to make the presentation. So I do not know whether it's coming up. Can you say me? Dipendu, Abhishek, anybody?
Sir, actually, your presentation is not in the S5 mode, sir.
I'm sorry, I can't listen to you properly. Sorry. Yes?
Sir, your presentation is not in the slideshow mode.
Is it so? But I am in the slideshow mode.
I think there is a few technical problems, sir, I think.
Yeah.
So we can see it now.
Okay. So bear with me, because this is a new technology to me.
Click the slides.
Okay. It speaks
on the screen.
Okay, I have fixed it. So I'm going on with this one. I do not know what is happening. I'm doing my level best. Okay, so it's going to be a time-consuming thing, you know, that I'm using a very fast internet, but why this is going on, I do not know. But still, I'm carrying on, Chaitali
ji. Okay, thank you.
So is it visible to you?
Yes, from it is what? Visible. And why? Take your
Come
time.
On. Okay, so
please take your time to make it understandable to all.
Okay, that's why I'm going through this one. So protect the lungs from the SARS-CoV infection. This ANG127, and these are the mechanism. These are the pathology, physiology, which is a normal one. So when these two things, AC1 and AC2, is very much important to us. And interestingly, one SCE1, it's coming to the from the chromosome number 17, which is autosome, common to male and female. And another SCE2 coming from the chromosome number 8, and which is not common to male and female. All of us knows that the females have 2X chromosomes, and while the males have 1X chromosome and one Y chromosome. So that is very interesting. The two things are coming from the two chromosomes and doing the same kind of thing. So that is actually the vital point that we can discuss later on. So this is a pathophysiology. If you can see the slide, you can see that. And the topmost, this is ACE, and there is SARS-CoV. So when it comes up, so from the ACE2 to ANG127 will be crossed up, that there will be no action if there is SARS-CoV. And that will make an upregulation, and there is a downregulation. So the downregulations to the ARB, angiotensin receptor blockers. And also, in case of the upregulation, what will happen? Hypertension, cardiofibrosis, and the thrombosis, and also the acute respiratory disorder. So what happens? That AC2 cannot make the ANG127. That's why making this kind of problem. So first, COVID invades the lungs and destroy the host cell. Lack of functional AC2 fails to respond the ANG to signaling, and complication arises just from here. So this is again pathophysiology. So once it is inside the host cell during the replication of the virus RNA, this makes some non-structural proteins. So these are different proteins named as ORF, and ORF means open reading frame. And what they do, they actually do abnormal hemoglobin metabolism, intense lung inflammation, hypoxia, multi-organ failure, abnormal immune responses, and cytokine storm. And this cytokine storm is very much important, because it makes autoimmune disease, that your own cell cannot understand which is cell and non-cell, so they will fight to each other. That will be the most important problem. So what happens, this cytokine that produced so much in case of the SARS-CoV-2, this is becoming 50 times higher than the Ebola virus, we know Zika or the West Nile virus infection. So 50 times higher. So these cytokine storms are very much important in this particular case. And what happened, what we find, that if you have higher hemoglobin, is related with the severity of the infection with SARS-CoV-2. Now, I will be talking about this higher hemoglobin levels, and definitely there are some issues that we can make a kind of relationship with the higher hemoglobin level and whether with the socio-demographic perspective. So this is again a particular, another protein is very much important, which is there in the plasma. Nowadays, the people can understand that there are lots of things that are coming up in the media about the plasma therapy and other kind of things. So this is the, eventually these things we are working with our students, that whether we can use some plasma things for this particular purpose, so that we can make this idea that how we can have some kind of risk factors, we can go from other kind of point. That is the virus invasion, so it makes some kind of tissue damage, and you can understand local reaction and there is systemic reactions. The people are talking about this systemic reaction. My previous speaker also said that behavioral problem will be there, physiological problem, biochemical problem, and nutritional problem. So in the last end of the of my topic, I will talk about this particular thing. So this is the activations of different kind of chemical reactions and other kind of things. So this haptoglobin has two more things important. This is a kind of hemoglobin binding and clearance protein. So this protein is important when there is hemolysis. I mean, this hemoglobin, I said the hemoglobins are bursting by the coronavirus, and then this particular protein take into because it is written efficient antagonistic to the HB toxicity. So if there is a bursting of hemolysis, so there will be a kind of toxicity. So they are clearing with the brooms and other kind of things. So human have distinct gene located on the chromosome 16. These are HP1 and HP2 allele. And what has been found, the plasma concentration is higher in case of the people having HP1 allele and than the HP2 allele. So the reverse, I'm sorry, the HP2 has most plasma concentration and HP1 has less plasma concentration. So now this higher hemoglobin is related to the greater severity of the infection I have already mentioned. Now, this higher hemoglobin is related to, associated with the gender. That is, you know, everybody we know, male is greater than the females, and the criteria has been set by WHO. This has been given 120 and 130 grams from gram per liter for the males. This has been given in 1994 by WHO, and also this is a kind of differentiation in case of the pregnant and the non-pregnant woman. And it is very much clear. Now, that is, hemoglobin is associated with the nutritional status, and as well as this nutritional status is very much related with the socioeconomic status. So I'm trying to make a kind of association between the biological perspective and the socio-demographic perspective in turn that can go for the cultural perspective, which is anthropological issue that I'm going to talk about, this holistic approach. So the World Health Organization already said the nutritional status and the socio-economic status. So finally, there is a question that can we take this per capita income with this socio-economic status? I feel that I might give you some kind of idea that we have taken into consideration, that if you go to the worldwide per capita income, you will find where the per capita income is higher, so there is case fatality rate is higher. If you go to the US, if you go to the Canada is 8.27, US is 5.36, and lower the per capita income, the case fatality rate is decreasing, and COVID case is also decreasing with the lower per capita income. So this is again a particular question that I'm raising here with the webinar, that whether coronavirus is making a kind of, trying to make any kind of equilibrium between the per capita income with the population and other population who doesn't have that kind of per capita income. So this is a question I'm raising here with the biological effect of the coronavirus and the socio-demographic perspective. So more the time goes, the people can have more data on it. So this is epidemiological factor, which is the study of the disease. that we need to know for the environment agent and the host. So these are very much important, environment and who is the agent. Now the agent we know for some kind of disease. For example, if I talk about malaria, so the and also the dengue, which is now is very much prevalent, is coming through the mosquitoes and the host. The host must be the human. And what we find, so these are the host risk factors that I'm coming to my point. So the what are the host risk factors? One is age specific, one is gender specific, one is ethnic specific, one is demographic structure, population density, co-residency. And this co-residency is very much important, definitely in case of the anthropology, because we do this kind of work about the familial situation, joint extended family, the residence and other kind of thing, and also the urbanization is very much important to us because urbanization is inevitable. So this urbanization will go with us, and this obesities and the comorbidities, and these particular comorbidities are very, very much important right now. The people are telling about this comorbidities and how the comorbidities are associated with the coronavirus and COVID attacks and other kind of things. So we have already, Choitaledi mentioned, we have already published this paper in the Asian Journal of Medical Sciences, and we have three authors. And I am very much proud that the author, Dr. Sindhu Chatterjee, will be talking after me. And so that is a pride for a teacher, that teacher and the student in the same platform is speaking something for the COVID-19. And then anthropology is a potentially important in emergency public health. So response, why? Because over the years, anthropology have been particularly valued for their ability to assess these factors in local context, which include three types of intervention. So one intervention is as program design and formative research that all the anthropology people does is interpretation, investigation, and the response. And finally, the most important thing for us, event analysis and post-hoc assessment. So what we got, and then we can have a post-hoc assessment. Now, this host risk factors, so age-specific, gender-specific, ethnic-specific, demographic structure, population density, obesity, urbanization, and comorbidities. Now, what we find in case of the age, that age is very much important for the comorbidities, because in case of Indian scenario, we get the mean age of India is 30. So in India, young people are working age group is 20 to 60 years are more affected, but because of their higher exposure, because, you know, we have to go for the manual laborers and migrating in a different states and other kind of things. So, but the mortality still is higher among the olders. The age is a foremost risk factor of the COVID-19. So what we find in case fatality rate, maximum we got from the demography, almost the data we have got is 45 to 59 and 60 to 74, while in China it is a 70 to 80 plus, and case fatality rate in Europe it is again 70 to 80 plus, and in US it is 75 to 85 plus. Now they have the more life expectancy, so we are getting this kind of data itself. Now the point we are coming with this, age is foremost risk factor for the COVID. Why? Because higher age increase the age too, that I have started the first one, your door of entering, entering the COVID-19. So this expression levels are very much higher in case of the aged. So which is increased by approximately 1.2 times with every 10 years of increased age. So you have more open door. So the chance of COVID-19 will be coming to your body is more and more. So that's why I'm telling you the age are very important to us. Now, national and international scenario of the gender differences, what we find in case of the male and female in India, the confirmed case male has higher, and also in the other countries it is higher. But in case of the females, what will happen in case of the India, females are much lesser, might be one of the reasons, because females are going outside for jobs and other kind of thing lesser in India than in the other countries. It might be our socialization process. So the two big exceptions we find in case of India, Bangladesh and Pakistan, where the females are lesser to go outside for their work and males are going outside. So might be they are much more exposed to this kind of infections. Now we are coming to case fatality ratio. What we find fatality, that is confirmed case, and one is case fatality ratio. So fatality means the death rate. Still we are finding the males having the death rate higher in all India and also to the other countries. Now, why males are in the higher risk? So we find some kind of things. I have already mentioned that S2 has the higher expression in the X chromosome, since females has one X chromosome, so the higher expression we find. Next, in MECA-X inactivation in the females, I have already mentioned in my paper, there is X inactivation in the females. So there will be a kind of heterogeneity in the X inactivations in the females. That's why it might be one of the reasons, biologically or genetically, what you say that females are less risk than the males. And then we are coming to the next point, what is called the innate immune response to the sex hormone like estrogens. So this estrogens for the females are very much important for limiting the comorbidities like cardiovascular disease, like type 2 diabetes, that are really lower risk in case of the female. Still, the females are on the menarche, but we do not know what happened to the females really in the menopause. So that is again a kind of question in the menopause, because the estrogen becomes seized. Now we are coming to the next sex hormone like androgen related to the male pattern of baldness. So that is again a point that some papers are related with that, whether the bald people are getting more affected with this COVID-19. So that is might be the relationship with the androgen related matter, because when there is androgen is a kind of male hormone. So this androgen gives some kind of male baldness pattern. So these are the host genetics. So we have found two things. One is ACID polymorphism. So I started with ACE1 and ACE2, and this ACE1 has two kinds of polymorphism. One is called insertion and one is called deletion. So we started with this one. These two are complementary to each other. And this is ACE1 associated with alternation in the circulating tissue concentration of ACE2. And ACE1 has a big polymorphism, which ACE2 doesn't have that kind of, that is in the X chromosome, doesn't have that kind of polymorphism. And this polymorphism becoming very much important in anthropological issue, because the polymorphism does mean the variation. So we try to understand the variation, and this, what we find, D allele is associated with the susceptibility of the disease. So what we find in the Western countries and the Western part of India, that we can give the example of Rajasthan, Maharashtra, and Gujarat, where the case fertility rate and the case rate is high, it might be due to the higher ACED alleles. So that allele is higher in Western countries, and you can understand there is a Caucasian influence in the Western part of India because of the migrations for a long time from the Western part to the Western India. And again, the haptoglobin polymorphism, I have already said that post-COVID, when the autopsy results have come from the Italy, what we find that is lungs, yes, lung is there, but the hypoxia having the thrombosis, that the hemolysis. So in that case, when the hemolysis is there, so that we need anti-inflammatory and immunomodulation, some kind of thing. So HP polymorphism is being a very high important things right now, because it comes in the plasma. Now this HP polymorphism, what we find, HP1 allele and HP2 allele possesses an ethnic variation. And what we find again in the HP1 allele and the severe outcome of this particular disease, and what we find in the Western countries and the Western part of India, HP1 allele again high. So my summarization is this, that ACED alleles are higher in the Western part and HP1 is high in the Western part. So it might be a kind of association with this case fatality rate. So I said about the risk factors. So the people who are admitted with this one might go, the people might go with this testing with this allele and HP allele for this particular reason. And now maybe a day before tomorrow, one medicine has been trialed. This is known as dexamethasone. And this is really a steroid anti-inflammatory. So this is again a point that we are thinking of anti-inflammatory, and already the people said that dexamethasone can be administered to the people who are already affected by the coronavirus. So this is actually coming, you can see that this is only in the 16th June that has been come up, and today is 19th. So whether the people can be used this dexamethasone, and this is a steroid, and you know the steroid works very fast. So it's a sort of fast relief that a person can get from different kind of respiratory disorder. Now the ethnic variation and the host genetics. So this is confirmed. I do not know how many of you are actually viewing my slides. So I'm sorry if not to everybody. So I have given a slide that in the Western region, we find higher prevalence of ACD and the HP1 allele is higher. While in the Northeastern region, if you go to the COVID tracker, you will find that Northeastern region are still now showing a very less case fatality rate. So least confirmed cases, death, and we got AC1 allele is prevalent and HP2 allele is higher. This might be an host genetics that actually giving a kind of idea to us that how anthropology can work, because these variation studies are only done by the anthropologist or the student of anthropology. I say like this, we always try to understand the variation, and that particular variation is very much interesting to us. Now the genetic study, you are coming, a lot of people are asking to me about this, maybe in the last, from the last week, the newspapers are coming, which kind of blood group you have. If you have O blood group, you are having the less risk and other kind of things. So the genetic study suggests that people's blood type may affect their COVID-19 risk factor. So as the student of anthropology, I can tell you that started with the blood group has been started with Landsteiner in 1900. But the serological differences between the blood of different race has come up by Hartsfield and Hartsfield in 1919. So after 19 years after the Landsteiner, it comes up with the use of anthropology that to be understood that blood group is not similar to all the population. And also there is a good book on the blood groups and disease published in 1978 by Oxford University. And you will be surprised to know that in 1965, the people worked on smallpox vaccination, that is AB1 rhesus blood group. And after that, one of our legend anthropologists of Calcutta University, Dr. Moni Sharanjan Chakravarti, has worked with Frederick Vogel, a very good geneticist from Germany. They have also published a paper on the 1966 on the ABO blood groups and the smallpox. So COVID is a virus and also smallpox is a virus. So there are some kind of relationship has been found. And we have also published some of the papers that on the cancer in the Bengali population and ABO blood group polymorphism and tuberculosis and association of ABO blood groups with prognosis of the gynecological cancer. Now, my point is this. Next, we would like to go for the blood type and biochemistry. So human disease, so it has been written. It is written, really, that blood types and biochemistry is there. So there are some kind of relationship with the blood types and the biochemistry. And what we got, that there are two types of blood cells. One is erythrocyte, one is white blood cells, what we call the leukocyte. And leukocyte is giving the immunity. So what we are talking about, the OA, B, AB blood group, these are from the red cells. And what we talk about these white blood cells, and you will find it in the media that people are talking about the HLA, which is known as human leukocyte antigen. So both things are very much important. So nevertheless, the blood group may be important case to understand the host risk factors. Now it is accessed that there are surface enzymes, so there are lots of human antigens are there. Maybe some kind of association can be found. So my point of this webinar is this, that COVID is a devastating form, right? But the thing is this, whether we can give some kind of idea about the risk factors that can be availed by the people who are already affected. Now we can make some kind of clinical management if we know about this one. So which people immediately want the ventilator, which people doesn't want the ventilator immediately. So we can think about with this particular variation. So now the O blood group people seems to be a very safe zone. Still now what we find that where in the Western region, O blood group is bit lower than where the A blood group is higher, but the higher O blood group we find again in Northeastern India, and the quest fatality rate, it coming up by 0.16%, while in case of the Western region, it comes up about 3.96%. So we will find that ACD, HP1, and non-O blood group is a real risk factor for the person who have already affected by the COVID. And if it is O blood group and HP2 and having ISEI or insertion are a bit in the safe zone. So this is clinical point. So why there is blood type O does not possess? Because O blood group does not possess any antigen and have only the antibodies. While the blood type A and B, it's a very fundamental thing, A antigen and B antigen, but the O doesn't have any antigen, but all antibodies. This might be one of the factor, major factor, that we can see that O blood group people seems to be at very safe zone. Now, if we go for the, I do not know, this is again a pictorial thing. I do not know how much I can able to explain you. Demographic structure of the population, if you go to the North America, Italy scenario 2019, all the 2019, what will happen? That all the population in the Europe and South America and the US, and as well as in China, if you think of a population pyramid, the wastes are becoming very much small, or the tip level is very much small because of demographic transition of the higher aged population. Nevertheless, one point is very much important, and also this is again an important point. If you go to the Europe and US, the people getting married, but they don't want to have the children. So again, the problem is this, the higher age group is getting increased. So, but in Indian scenario, we are typically in the triangular or the dome shepherd, where we get the lower age, the higher fertility and lower middle age group is very much important to us. So the region like America, Europe, China, the narrower base, lower percentage of younger people, typically of aging population or near sub-replacement fertility are more risk that we are talking about in case of the COVID. Now, population in structure, what we find, the mean age of other countries like Germany or we say the US, the mean age being 45, while in India, the mean age is around 29-30. So what we find, there is a relationship between the mean age and the case fatality rate. So lower the mean age, lower the case fatality rate. We are finding out still now when we go for the available data set. Now the population, interestingly, population density become one of the major risk factor. Now I do not know how many of again you are visualizing my slide. I'm just giving you the number. In the eastern region, the population density per square kilometer is 625. While in the western region, the population density per square kilometer is 344. While the death rate in the eastern region is lower, despite of the higher population density. It is 625 and the case fatality rate is 2.29%. And while in the western part of India, this density, population density per square kilometer is 344, we are getting case fatality rate 3.96. So does it mean that above the population density, something is working on? So we have already mentioned about the host genetics. We have already mentioned about some kind of biological parameters. And also I have said about the per capita income, which is very much important. I have already raised this question, so whether the people can give feed me back the things that where we are getting per capita income higher hemoglobin can be associated because of the socioeconomic status and the nutritional status. And we are getting coronavirus pandemic over there much more than lesser per capita income. Now the population density and the co-residency pattern, what we find, higher population density than community transmission is there. Next, this is the reason for higher prevalence and case fatality rate with the dense population. And also The problem is interfamilial transmission. So every anthropology who are working on anthropology, we know about it, that in the rural India, there is always a chance of having joint extended family than the urban, where we get the nuclear family much more. So if there is a nuclear family, that particular family can maintain the physical distance. I would like to mention one thing that people are talking about some social distance, but the student of anthropology, we should not say about the social distance, because communication is being one of the social factors. So we can say only the physical distancing. We are doing the physical distancing, not the social distancing, because we are communicating to each other for every aspect. My point is this, where in urban population, what we find that there is a nuclear family, so there is always a chance for a nuclear family to maintain the physical distance as much as possible. But in case of the joint extended family in rural India, this is really a problem with this things with getting more space for making the physical distancing. This is again the problem of Indian scenario and in the urban, I mean the rural scenario. Now, rural versus urban, what we find from 1995 to 2020, there is a lot of migrations from the rural to urban. So what do we find urban? Why urbanization? Because it's migrations for different kind of jobs and other kind of things in the urban. But this urban scenario is making somewhat, because India is the tip of the iceberg. Because when the migrant people came up here, so most of the migrant people are hailing from the rural area. Now, it's become fatal in the rural area because of the weaker health infrastructure than the cities. So what will happen to the rural area when there are a lot of migrants, people are coming and lesser weaker health infrastructure than the cities. So that's why I'm telling you India is at the tip of the iceberg. So what the people are thinking about to test, this is only one thing that to go for the test, whether how many people making the stratified random sampling. On the basis of the population density, we must go for the testing. How many people are positive? So nowadays, the people are working on the testing, not with the RT-PCR, but they want to do with the testing on the basis of antibody, which also can give you a good result after some time. Now, the obesity-driven comorbidities, the point is this. Obesity is also a very much important factor for the comorbidities. So the comorbidities are very much important to us, because obesity, yes, the respiratory dysfunction, comorbidities like the cardiovascular disease, diabetes mellitus, kidney disease, metabolic disease, hypertension. So there are lots of things that people are making intermingled. I started with this COVID makes a Trojan horse, that we do not know where it will come up, because COVID means that a kind of pain drive, you know, a lot of information is there now. Only thing, you need a good computer to go on. So that good computer is a good host of this kind of anomalies with the immunity purpose. So apple shepherd or central obesity is higher in the older people and also in the men than in young adults, maybe a reason for their high mortality with the COVID-19. Now, what we find the underlying condition right now, it is March 31st in 2020, what we find underlying conditions in the hospitalization rate is 40.5%. So 40.5% is going with this underlying conditions, where no underlying conditions for the COVID patient are admitted to the hospital is only 9%. Now, COVID-19 impact beyond the health crisis. So what the health crisis already mentioned by Professor Basav Chaudhary, that the health crisis being pandemic has significantly disturbed the education system. Yes, because what I'm talking about right now, somebody can see my presentation, somebody cannot see. Also, this online class is really not that particular thing, you know, when we talk to in front of the students, so 1:1 is very much important. Right now, this is also a kind of joke, that you can see my half through the webcam. So all the things that when I teach to the students, I can see them, they can see us, see me. So that will be a kind of student-teacher relationship, which are really we are not finding. Apex student-teacher interaction in learning. Learning in the rural area is completely shut down for not having access to e-learning. Students are not getting midday meals subject to the economic and social stress. The global 19 and economy, what happened? The global 19 pandemic is exacting the terrible human toll and menacing the world economy, a sharp decrease in the worldwide economic growth, change in the employment rate, less jobs, exacerbates poverty risk. And also this comes together to the meltdown illness. And we are really thinking of possible, is there any possible demographic transition that I have already mentioned, that a lower age group is less in case of the developed country who has the more higher per capita income, and the higher age are people are having this COVID-19. So again, this is possible demographic transition. And I feel Professor Chaudhary already mentioned about a term which is called Malthusian theory, because the resources are increasing with arithmetic progression, and the human population is going with a geometric progression. So sometimes natural calamities try to make it equilibrium. So I have already mentioned about this equilibrium with the high income countries like per capita income. Now finally, COVID-19 hits employment in India, expected decline in the global mercantile trade, and coronavirus affects the global economic growth. With all odds, only thing SARS-CoV noticeably impacted the environment by preservation and restoration of the environmental equality. That we all find that it's a really environment quality is better in this particular SARS-CoV because of this lockdowns and less traffic and other kind of things. So only the plus point that we can think of the environment by preservation and restoration of the environmental quality. So concluding remark, I'm going just at this last slide. I'm talking about the concluding remarks. So there are some genetic factors I have already mentioned, ACD allele, higher level of hemoglobin, HP1 allele, non-O blood type, and obesities. These are the most risk factors. And epigenetic factor, population aging, higher population density, co-residency, and the urbanization. So these are the two things I right now can make an association between the biology and the socio-demographic perspective, because human as well as in biology and as well as the socio-demography, what we say, the cultural part of thing. So prevention is always better than cure. So the point, my point is this, if we go for the clinical management with thinking with this particular host genetic variation and taking these epigenetic factors, so I feel that will be the preventive measure that we can fight with the COVID-19 in coming days. So thank you so much. I don't know how much of you can see my slides. I'm sorry for that because I'm not really able to show you the slides. Thank you so much, Chaitanya. It's over to you.
Sir, I do have one question.
Yes, please.
You elaborately discuss the blood type and the risk factor for COVID-19.
If a person
has O or O plus blood group and his hemoglobin level is low, so what will be the risk factor for this particular person?
If that there is O blood group, I'm not going to the positive and you say for plus, right?
Yeah.
You say plus. So plus is the Rh factor. So this is, we should not go for the Rh factor.
Yeah.
The thing is this, Rh factor, you know, Rh positives are higher in, very high in frequency. So we should not go for the Rh factors.
Okay.
So we must confine ourselves to the blood group like O. You said O blood group and lower hemoglobin. I say this is a less risk for the COVID-19. Less risk.
Okay. Due to the availability of plasma there?
Yes, plasma is there always because you have the plasma content and one is cell content, right? Yeah. So the plasma content is there where the antibody lies.
Yeah.
What I said about the O blood group, O blood group doesn't have any antigen for the whole of antibodies.
Antibodies are plenty.
Yes, antibodies. So people are using right now the antibody test. You know that medias are coming up with the antibody tests. So sometimes the antibody tests we should go because RT-PCR are taking sometimes more time. So we should really, whether we have a lot more time to do this kind of things, I do not know. So the point, my point is this, we need to go for as far as possible for the testing.
Thank you, sir.
I'm there if any question. Is there any question?
Since we are running,
Sir, since planning beyond the schedule, may
okay,
I request Choitali Di to continue with the next speaker, madam?
Oh, sure.
Choitali,
sure.
Madam, please. Sir, you can look into the chat box and answer if possible
surely
in the chat box, sir.
Surely,
I'm going through.
Choitali, madam. I think Choitali, madam, having some problem with the network. So
hello.
Choitali,
hello.
Madam.
Prodipto, am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Now I am introducing our next speaker. In fact, our last speaker. Already time is, there is shortfall of the time. Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee. Sorry, Diptendu, we are late.
Good evening.
Please.
Good evening.
Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee, done MSc from Calcutta University, postgraduate diploma in bioinformatics from IISWBM, PhD from Calcutta University, postdoctoral fellow of IIIT Madras, got Indian National Science Academy Fellowship, received Young Scientist Award from Indian Science Congress, published more than 50 number of research papers, 7 books, and several book chapters. His specialized area of work, non-communicable disease, molecular disease, and population demography, population variation based on biological variables, stem cell research, tissue culture, and biomaterial and tissue regeneration is another area of interest of Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee. Presently, he is in the post of Deputy Registrar in Calcutta University and Assistant Professor of Anthropology in Calcutta University. He is also a life member of Indian Science Congress and Indian Anthropological Society. He is now supervising more than 10 research scholars and India in different research institutions. I may invite Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee. We are waiting for your discussion.
Good evening. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. It's a pleasure for me just to be here, and it's also a good time. And I will talk on the topic, a deep look into the socio-biological impact of COVID-19. This is a very much thought-provoking and scintillating topic, as a respected Vice Chancellor Sir and Professor Shroma De, the Principal, Hiralal Mojumdar Memorial College, Professor Shakti Broto Bhoumik, Principal, APC College, Dr. Choitali Bhattacharya, my dear friend Prodipto, and Professor Arvind N. Ansari, and my teacher, Professor Arup Ratan Bandhabadhyay, all the faculty members, dear friends, my students. So it is very important topic, and we have already published few papers during this time, and yet few papers are on the queue. But I will, as Sir has already focused on the biological aspect of the COVID-19 and the biological effect on the COVID-19. And I have decided to highlight on the socio-biological impact of COVID-19. As an anthropological person, definitely I will try to show you the effect on population of COVID-19. So hundreds of, visible my slides?
Yeah, you are visible. Okay, slides are visible.
Okay. Hundreds of coronavirus known to exist, many are relatively harmless, as we know in the newspapers. So coronavirus infect the nose, sinus, and upper throat, but often result in nothing more than a common cold. And pandemic in general are not merely serious public health concerns, rather they trigger distress, socio-economic and political crisis in the infected countries. COVID-19, apart from becoming the greatest threat to global public health of the century, is being considered as an indicator of inequity and deficiency of social advancement. This is the problem. So we have to understand the problem. As is implied in the name COVID-19, co mean the corona, vi mean virus, and d mean the disease, and 19 is the occurrence year. So this is the COVID-19. Coronavirus is a single-stranded RNA virus with a diameter ranging from 80 to 120 nanometer. The first modern COVID-19 pandemic was reported in December 2000. As we know, in the Wuhan and the Hubei province, it has been reported. And coronavirus belong to a large, diverse family of virus. These can be categorized into four genera, namely alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. All the previously discussed coronavirus responsible for worldwide spread of pandemic, namely SARS, MERS-CoV, and SARS-CoV-2, and beta coronavirus. Related story, few stories are there. It is estimated that there may be tenfold more asymptomatic carriers of the disease, which means that there could be over 7.5 million carriers worldwide. This is a disease that is spreading very rapidly across the globe. Even with corona virus that causes common cold, it's unclear whether humans develop long-term immunity to this virus or need to continually develop new immunities. That is, we know it is already very much discussed, that is herd immunity. This is for this reason the lockdown has been withdrawn. For a virus, this is the also another related story is there. For a virus that originates in an animal species to successfully infect human, it needs to adapt to range of genetic differences between the original host species and human. Here is the host is the human. But effective vaccine can ultimately withdraw such pathogens. International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses, ICTV, named the virus as Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2, that is SARS-CoV-2. According to WHO, in 2002 and 2003, more than 8,000 people suffered and 774 died of a coronavirus called SARS. And we know the MERS, that is also there is a story. Due to paucity of time, it is not possible for me to describe in detail. So this is the using social and behavioral science, that is the anthropology, to support COVID-19 pandemic response. Within 3 months, the virus has spread to more than 118,000 cases and caused 4,291 deaths in 114 countries, leading the World Health Organization to declare a global pandemic. This has been happening within 3 months, and other countries of the world, they are generally unaware of it. And in the month of March, most of the country has taken the step of lockdown. And the social and behavioral science can provide valuable insights for managing the pandemic and its impact. The objective of the present presentation is to discuss topics that are broadly relevant to numerous stages of the current pandemic to help policymakers, leaders, and the public better understand how to manage threats, navigate different social and cultural contexts, improve science communication, align individual and collective interests, employ effective leadership, and provide social and emotional support. The facts inside the implication for policies should be interpreted with caution because there is a very little published social science research on the current pandemic. Thus, our discussion often draws from different circumstances that the current pandemic and the quality of the evidence cited varies substantially. Yes, because as a resource person, my duty is to collect the data and play a role of a coordinator to coordinate the data and the information to give the highlight to the society to become safe from the disease. The present presentation focus on the describe the quality of evidence of facilitate careful critical engagement by readers and call for the scientific community to mobilize rapidly to produce research to directly inform policy and individual and collective behavior in response to the pandemic. There is threat perception also. Historically, infectious diseases have been responsible for the greatest human death tolls. For example, the bubonic plague killed approximately 25% of the European population. The threat. One of the central emotional responses during a pandemic is fear. It is the primary threat. Human, like other animals, possesses a set of defensive system for combating ecological threats. Navigate emotions resulting from threat can be contagious, and fear can make threats appear more imminent. A meta-analysis focused that targeting fears can be useful in some situations. It is very useful. We have seen in the during the time of lockdown, but not others. Appealing to fear leads people to change their behavior if they feel capable of dealing with the threat, but leads to defensive reactions when they feel helpless to act. It is the real problem now. Emotion and risk perception. Sound health decisions depend on accurate perception of the cost and benefits of certain choice for oneself and for society. Emotions often drive risk perception, sometimes more so than factual information. As negative emotion increase, people may rely on negative. Prejudice and discrimination. The experience of fear, it is already, as government is giving the in the telephone, we are ringing the telephone and we are seeing the television and in the radio and different part, government is giving the different information that and negative information. It is the bad driver, so we should go with the positive emotions. So disaster and panic. There is a common belief in popular culture. There like the different, so many popular cultures are there, that when in peril, people panic, especially when in crowds. That is, they act blindly and excessively out of self-preservation, potentially engaging the survival of all. This idea has been used to explain responses to the current COVID-19 outbreak, most commonly in relation to the notion of panic buying. However, close inspection of what happened in disasters reveal a different picture. Certainly, some people do act selfishly, and some, especially those who are particularly vulnerable, may experience more distress. They can foster the very individualism and competitiveness that turn sensible preparations into dysfunctional stockpiles and undermine the sense of collective purpose which facilitates people supporting one another during an emergency. Social context. Slowing viral transmission during pandemic requires significant shift in behavior. We have seen various aspects of social and cultural context influence the extent and speed of behavior change. A new cultural aspect or cultural behavior or new popular culture has been arising. Now, as the cinemas has been released in the different halls, now all the cinemas have been released in the web platform. This is the change of popular culture and different a change of behavior. Social norms. People's behavior is influenced by social norms. What they, it is very important here that we have changed the social norms because we are following the social distances. We are not doing any social functions, and we are not entering in the temple, mosque, and the churches. And we are giving the government and the rules has given, imposing different restriction on our behavior. So there is a different social norms in on us, and we are showing different lifestyles. So changing behavior by correcting such misperceptions can be achieved by public message reinforcing positive norms. Therefore, message that provide in group models for norms may therefore be most effective. Social norms, social network can amplify the spread of behavior. That is the now we are doing the social networking or the social contacting that are both harmful and beneficial during an epidemic, and these effects may spread to the network to friends. The virus itself spread from person to person, and since people centrally located in network come into contact with more people, they are often among the first to be infected. The social inequality, there is so many example of social inequality. It is another problem of any pandemic issue. The homeless person, the homeless cannot shelter in place. families in housing without running water cannot wash their hands frequently. People who are detained by a state may lack space to implement physical distancing. People without health insurance may delay or avoid seeking testing or treatment. People who rely on public transport cannot always avoid large crowds, and low-wage workers are often in occupations where remote work is impossible and employees do not offer paid sick leave. So economic disadvantage is also associated with the pre-existing condition associated with higher morbidity rates once infected, such as compromised immune system, diabetes, heart disease, and chronic lung disease like asthma, and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease like COPD. There is a social inequality. Issue of economic disadvantage intersects with the issues of race and ethnicity. Members of minority communities are disproportionately found among the homeless, the detained, the workers in high public contact but low benefit occupations, and those with prior health conditions that make them more vulnerable. Culture, a sense of self as independent versus interdependent with other in a dimension of cultural variation. There is a two part, there is independent and another is the interdependent. The cultures that endorse individualism are considered independent, whereas whether we will maintain the social distance, it is depend on us. It is independent cultural practice. Whether we will go to the crowd, it is the independent factor that whether it is this decision depends on me. While medical or whether we will do any such kind of religious activity, this is interdependent. Whether we will go to the workplace, it is the interdependent culture. So there it is not only depend on the decision of the individual. This another reason why interpersonal transmission of the virus could be more likely independent culture than in interdependent cultures. Another related dimensions, the slide is not showing.
No, slide is not showing. Slide is not even on the screen. Dipthintu, slide is not on the screen.
The tight rules regarding social distancing are critical, yet looseness within this constraint, they may also help form the development of creative technical solutions that are needed to contain the pandemic, as well as creating novel tools to help people feel connected. Political polarization is important. In the daily, in the newspaper, we are seeing the different opinion from the different political parties. So that is the attitudinal polarization is another important factor. The effective polarization has political consequences such as decreasing trust, prevailing the partisan level over policy information, and believing false information that can undermine social and economic relationships and impair public health. Science communication. The information environment around a pandemic underscores the importance of effective science communication. The COVID-19 pandemic has already been a rise conspiracy theory, fake news, and misinformation. The conspiracy theory, it is very important. The conspiracy theory, the main important that the some concern the origin of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, for example, it has been bioweapon created by the China to wage war on the US or the vice versa. We don't know what is the truth. Other focus on the prevention and cure, for instance, the conventional medical treatment should not be trusted and that people should use alternative remedies to ward off the virus. We don't know what is the fact. So all these the stories
are that come on the conspiracy theories. The fake news and the misinformation, it is another very important part. Fake news and misinformation about COVID-19 have proliferated widely on social media. Different people are giving different news. We don't know what is the truth. The emerging research is using social science to understand and counter the spread of fake news. One approach is to debunk using fact-checking and correction. One, pre-bunking approach involves psychological inoculation. Inoculation follows the biomedical analogy. People are exposed to a several weekend dose of a persuasive argument strong enough to trigger the immune system, but not so strong as to overwhelm it. Aligning individual and collective interests, the behavior of individual living in communities is regulated by moral norms and values. People who do what is right are respected and publicly admired, while those who don't is wrong are devalued and socially excluded. Zero-sum thinking means that while it might be psychologically compelling to hold protective materials, that is sanitizer, mask, vaccine, beyond what is necessary, doing so could be self-defeating. Given the importance of slowing infection, it may be helpful to make people aware that others' access to preventive measures is a benefit to oneself. This is the zero-sum thinking. Moral decision making during a pandemic involves uncertainty. It's not certain whether social interactions will infer others. People may be less willing to make sacrifice for others when the benefits are uncertain. So it is, people are not ready to sacrifice for anybody, as because they love, everybody loves himself much. When people make moral decisions, they often consider how others would judge them for behaving selfishly, as because whether we heard the news, our neighbor is seriously ill. So maybe 4 months before, we may help our neighbor, but now we are not ready to help the neighbor also. Therefore, reframing decision to carry on with business as usual during a pandemic as active decision. Cooperation within group. So in particular, there is a conflict between short-term and self-interest versus long-term and collective interest. Several techniques such as sanctioning defectors of rewarding cooperation for cooperators tend to increase cooperative behavior in laboratory experiments using economic games following the golden rule. We all know the golden rule, what to do and what not to do. So fighting a global pandemic requires large-scale cooperation. So leadership is very important. Crisis like the COVID-19 pandemic creates an opportunity for leadership across group of varying levels, families, workplace, local communities, and nations. Leadership can coordinate individual and help them avoid behaviors that are no longer considered socially responsible. Trust and compliance. During a pandemic, health officials often need to persuade the population to make a number of behavior changes and follow health policies aimed at containment, that is holding the quarantine or reporting voluntarily for medical testing. Correlational evidences from Liberia in different countries, we have already showed the different examples. So identity leadership, experimental studies clarify what leaders can do to promote trust leading to cooperation. A priority for leader is to create a sense of shared social identity among their followers. We are seeing in the television that different celebrities and different special persons, they are giving bite on the television to eradicate the fear and give the original true news to the general people. So elevating the in-group without demeaning others, building a strong sense of shared social identity can help coordinate efforts to manage threats and foster in-group commitment and adherence to norms. Leaders can do this, for instance, by being a source of moral elevation. Stress and coping. So everybody is under stress, and we have to cope up with the situation and cope up with the new rules of our life and change of behavioral changes of our life. So all these other trace and copying skill of cultural part and social isolation and connection. So in absence of vaccine and during the pandemic situation and whether when the golden rule is applied to our life, we have maintained the all the rules, that is social isolation and connection is very important. So distancing threatens to aggravate feeling of loneliness. So now problem is people are really alone and could produce negative long-term health consequences. Online interactions can also foster a sense of connection. Both receiving, giving support online can bolster the psychological well-being. Intimate relationship, the social effects of the pandemic also extend to the inside of our home, where many people find themselves in sudden close proximity with their immediate family. People subject to quarantine or self-isolation are at risk for confusion and anger, emotional tendencies, and can be explosive when multiple household members simultaneously endure them for weeks or months or end. Healthy mindset. So now in this situation, the people are very much frustrated. And where we are coming to the online, sometimes we feel comfortable, but not the all time. So we want to come in our daily life, in our original daily life, in our daily activity. So World Health Organization declared that health communication is seen to have relevance for virtually every aspect of health and well-being, including disease prevention, health promotion, and quality of life. It is very important. We have to improve our quality of life. There is a certain downfall in the quality of life. We have to improve it. This is the only way to cope up with the situation. The socioeconomic impact, there is a very already discussed my previous persons. They have already discussed the socioeconomic part. So there is a distress in the, there is a devastating fall in the economic part and the occupational part depending on the COVID-19. So UN framework for the immediate socioeconomic response to the COVID, and the COVID is pandemic is far from the health crisis. It is affecting societies and economic at their core. Without urgent socioeconomic responses, global suffering will escalate, jeopardizing life and livelihood for years to come. It takes a long time. Socioeconomic, this is the United Nations has already said, and WHO already said, and different countries are facing, and the global WHO already highlighted that the global humanitarian response plan we have to make, we have to come out from this problem. So COVID outbreak, migration, effective society, global environment and prevention COVID, which is very important for migration. The people are coming from different places, that if they are going from the places to another place, this is the problem. So how they will interact with the present environment, how they will cope up with their present environment, it is a challenge for us. And striking countries, entire educational, commercial, sports and spiritual institutions are closed, and now they are open. Restricting mass gathering, the golden rule, the preventing SARS-CoV transmission by restricting mass gathering. We are not doing this now. But during the unlock period, people are dissolving in different places. This is the medicine. There is no such kind of medicine, and now there is no such kind of vaccine also. So far, there are no exact antiviral treatment or vaccine for COVID-19 disease. Therefore, it is an urgent necessity of time to develop a safe and stable COVID-19 vaccine. Forestation, we have to maintain the forestation as a result of COVID-19 and different aspect of COVID-19. The deforestation has been taken place. So forest reforestation is very important to change the environment, controlling human population growth. Environment, it is the very, now we are in very floating and lucid situation. So we have to have control the population growth in different countries. So revealing exceedingly vulnerable population to new pathogens by increased human relocation. So it is very important term, the relocation to previously isolated area may bring together infectious disease. Control of population growth is therefore very essential, all this regard. Our future steps. So during the last few months, we have to follow the golden rule. We have to follow the truth, the real news. Whatever is the cause of origin, the occurrence of COVID-19 has emphasized to improve the mutually effective connections between human and nature. So it is the very anthropological significance of interaction of human and nature interaction. It is the challenge given by the nature to us. In this point of time, it is indispensable to control the source of disease, cut off the transmission path, and use the existing drug and means to control the progress of the disease proactively. Like all the preceding distress on the earth, let all definitely win over the pandemic in due course of time, but they should know the limit to which they can trust nature before it is too late. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Diptendu. Thank you for your resourceful conversation. I hope the audiences have enjoyed it. I am sorry for the late hour. Please adjust, and as for your inconvenience, again, we are sorry from the committee of the organizing committee. Thank you all. Thank you all. Have there any questions, please? I found in the chat box different persons asking for the video or slide for the discussions. Can you provide us?
Yes, definitely. Definitely we'll give the
Prodeep, you must communicate in this regard. And thank you again. I am giving my mic to Dr. Shoma Ghosh. Shoma, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, now you conclude the session. Please.
Actually, I'm really thankful to all the speakers. And of course, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, and Principal APC College, coordinators of IQAC of both the colleges, Chandra Boli, Pradipta, and all others associated with this endeavor. I am indebted to Professor Choitali Bhattacharya for all her advice. And as we know that COVID-19 has affected global economy and society so bitterly that world is apprehending the greatest recession and social, in true sense, social distancing in the history of society and economy. And we should better start saying that it is only physical distancing, not social distancing. Because we got 250 participants in this webinar. So it was only a physical distance. It was not a social distance, not a distance through in communicating our intellects. We'll meet you all again tomorrow. We'll have such an illuminating session again tomorrow. And till then, have a wonderful evening. Have a wonderful night. And let's wait for tomorrow's session. I hope that it would be as good as the present one. I must convey my thanks to Professor Ansari, Professor Arupraton Arup sir, Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee, and all others who were with us till the end of the program. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.